Good evening and welcome. My name is Matt Kunkel, the director of tonight's cabaret. For artists, the COVID-19 pandemic has brought challenges unlike anything we've ever experienced before. Fortunately, we live in a digital age which permits us to work together in asynchronous ways regardless of our physical location. Now I know what you're thinking. No, we're not all gathered together at GSA waiting for the house lights to dim and the show to begin. But what matters is that in this moment, in the safest way we can, we are together, in real time, gathered to support these incredible students and the magnificent art they've made. And I want you to imagine, as you're watching tonight's show from wherever you are, that you're sitting in GSA's Black Box Theater, all together, wrapped up in the magic that is live theater. So until we can gather again, I'm pleased to welcome you to tonight's virtual cabaret.
Most prolific theatrical composers in history. Her career includes 5 Broadway musicals, 5 Tony nominations, including a win for Funhome, 3 Drama Desk Awards, and she is a 2-time Pulitzer Prize finalist. Tonight, we explore her life, her work, and her impact on the theater community. Growing up, Jeanine's piano teacher put equal value into all styles of music, from Carol King to Shostakovich. You can hear this respect for genre in Jeanine's later works. But life in the theater was not always in Jeanine's plan. She originally studied organic chemistry at Barnard College with the plans of becoming a doctor. but her boyfriend convinced her to reconsider when she was teaching at Stage Door Manor during one of her summer breaks. She transferred to Columbia's music school and hit the ground running. For the next 5 years, she worked on 15 Broadway musicals as a musician and arranger, quickly learning what it takes to make a musical masterpiece.
Violet served as her transition from music direction and conducting to writing and composing. Violet was developed at the Eugene O'Neill Theater Center in 1994 and premiered at Playwrights Horizon in 1997. The production earned her an Obie Award and a Lucille Lortel Award for Best Musical. Jeanine says that she is always interested in the invisible person, the person society has deemed unworthy of being the protagonist. Violet is a perfect example of this. It has been described as a dark American Cinderella story, following a disfigured woman's cross-country journey by bus as she looks for a road to healing. When writing Violet, Jeanine said, "Look, if it goes no further than the living room, that's where it goes. I'm not writing for its life. Violet appealed to me. The character, the story, and if it doesn't get out of my living room, that's okay."
Is this a suitcase? Is it mine? Am I waiting by the candy stand? Underneath the Greyhound station sign, have I got a ticket in my hand? Stupid. People of Spruce Pine are stupid. Lord, I'll call the whole trip off if Leroy Evans looks me in the face. Nope, I win. He's terrorized. This town is a superstitious place. Next week, won't they be surprised? Mr. Wallace Weatherman, give my scar a surprised. Got my healing planned out in my book. Next week, I'll come back disguised. He sure thinks well of himself, but what does he have, really? Lips thin, cheeks flat. I sure don't want mine like that. Nose bent, ears runts.
Where I intend, 'cause it seems to un- Violet made its Broadway debut at the American Airlines Theater in 2014, 17 years after its original production. Now, revisiting a musical after 17 years is really tough. Imagine your parents came up to you when you were 17 and were like, let's start over, you're a baby again. But by the time Violet reached its Broadway premiere, Jeanine felt more comfortable and confident as an artist, and when it was originally written, she was pregnant, and similar to our titular character, felt nervous about starting her own profound journey of motherhood. But by revisiting it nearly two decades later, as both a parent in life and of the show, she and her writing partner Brian Crawley came back as scientists to really re-examine the material. And they decided to remove some of the original material for the Broadway revival, including the song you just heard, You're Different. Jeanine said the song felt too slow and that the idea was too general, that Monty had a hunger and a yearning just as much as Violet, and we needed to hear that forward-moving desire. And they wrote a song for the revival that does just that.
Last time I came to Memphis, all it took was two beers. Had a girl on her back, her feet up by my ears. I like the kind of girlfriends you pick up in a bar, who know what to make of the promises barroom promises are. A couple of shots. Nobody's asking, no one's thoughts. Someone who don't give a damn. That's what I come to Memphis for. That's all I want and nothing more. So here I am, the open door. I ain't a boy in the skin of a man. I'm more the skin that you let off. The rolling candle you blind by the road that you to set off. The truth is never so bad. Try and wrap your mind around that. Last time I came to Memphis, and this girl kicked her out, then went back for the waitress. That chick would shout. That's why I come to Memphis. That's what Memphis is for. If you come with a pulse, then you're going to score. Some smoking babes, a couple. Nobody's asking, no one's thoughts. That's what they get. They know the scam. You know what? They don't give a damn. So here I am, and so are you. You give a damn. Here I am.
The gravy, I'll take the oyster, songs the pearl, pinching pennies, clipping coupons, see a brand new world unfurl. Let me brown bag all my lunches, try my hand at canned cuisine, a Berlitz class I long to pass, how the other half lives. No 14-carat cronies, phonies, fair weather friends. I want an on the doll mate, soulmate, stormy weather friends. Pour me the milk, but hold the honey. Bring on those bunny money woes, paying Paul by robbing Peter, lay away to buy my clothes. Summer on the Isle of Coney, winter in Hell's Kitchenette. I'll turn my dial to rank and file, how the other half lives poor? Not me, honey, I don't want those money woes. I'll marry Paul or Dave or Rob or Peter so I can buy my clothes at Saks Fifth Avenue, Bergdorf's Goodman too, the privileged few plus you know who. How the other half lives. I'm on the way up.
I'm on the way down.
It's a good thing we met in the middle. Poor, not me.
But hold the honey, I don't
bring
want
on those funny money woes. I'll marry Paul or Dave or Rob or Peter.
Lay
so I can buy my clothes.
Sack
summer on Fifth Avenue. Bergdorf's Goodman too.
A wild social.
So I can learn living like the other half.
Thousands of people way down below, wandering to and fro. Tireless people, no time to lose, crowding these avenues and parks. On their marks, racing fast, quite a cast. Millions of people, pick any two, and they could be just like you and me. Used to be, way back when, strangers. Then I turned the corner, and there you stood. Your smile like home to me, your heart familiar. No use pretending, not that I could. I turned the corner when I met you. I turned the corner, stopped on a dime. Like I'd forgotten someone long forgotten. No mere flirtation, and no marking time. I turned the corner when I met you. When I met you, was our encounter planned? Destiny's guiding hand, fortune or fate is grand. The way you make me feel. I turned the corner when I met you. I turned the corner when I met you.
At its core, Millie represents every person brave enough to pack their bags and buy a one-way ticket towards their dreams. Our next song was written as a love letter to New York City and the resilience of its people, something more resonant today than ever before. Some have recently said that New York is dead, but even in 2020, New York has remained the cultural hub of the world. No matter what the future has in store, the city that never sleeps will always be home to the biggest dreamers.
Of the world are said to stop at seven, but truth to tell, my figures don't agree. I'd number them at eight, with one so close to heaven. The others pale, their magic stale. Just take a look and see. Step right up.
Treasure Isle. Every inch of it, a sky mile. Fairy tale land, only in New York. Hey, castle builder, want the moon and nothing less. Work for years, then overnight success. I know firsthand, only in New York. Each day it's free admission to those who dream. You set your sights all the way upstream. Off you go, for you know that cream will rise. Make that wish, seek that thrill. Go and get it, 'cause you always will. Strike up the band, only in New York. Day it's free admission to those who dream. You set your sights all the way upstream. Off you go, for you know that cream will rise, will rise. New and proved and rearranged, it's ever changing, yet it never changed. Oh, life on command. Hear what I'm saying? Oh, but it's grand. That's why I'm staying right here as planned. Only in New York. Only in New York.
Gimme Gimme is the big 11 o'clock number of Thoroughly Modern Millie. An 11 o'clock number refers to the penultimate song in a musical where the lead character must have a big moment that ties the events together and fully reveals their character's arc. It garnered this nickname because curtain used to be at 8:30 p.m. and the average musical lasted 2.5 hours. So by the time that 11 o'clock came, the audience could anticipate that this climactic number in which the lead character must make a life-changing decision, was soon to come. In Millie's case, she must grapple whether to marry for money or for love. When Thoroughly Modern Millie was in the middle of its technical rehearsal at its out-of-town tryout at La Jolla Playhouse, Gimme Gimme had yet to be written. So when they reached the 11 o'clock spot in tech, the entire company raced to the lobby to see what Jeanine and Dick had created. They sang the big climactic ending, but before they could get any feedback, the stage manager had called them back from their 5-minute break. Jeanine and Dick looked at each other, asking, "Was it any good? Did it work?" They figured, well, let's just try it for now until we write something better. But that night, they heard Sutton Foster sing it, and they knew it was a hit.
Simple choice, nothing more, this or that, either or. Merry, well, social world, businessman, clever girl, or pin my future on a green glass love. What kind of life am I dreaming of? Say, gimme, 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 gimme.
Jeanine Tesori says, "Broadway is always a risk. You just don't know how a piece will resonate with an audience. So much is alchemy and timing, and so much is how the writing hits the emotional temperature of an audience, where they are in their lives and who they are walking into that theater. Our next piece, Carolina Change, is a prime example of this risk. Jeanine, along with book writer and lyricist Tony Kushner, grappled with how to end the piece, and they went through 9 million versions before they found something that worked. And though Tesori said she didn't always intend to end the show with an epilogue from the perspective of Caroline's child, she and Kushner felt a responsibility to them. The United States was built on generations of women who were treated as machinery, and Caroline had to sacrifice her spirit and her dreams so that her children could be an agency for change. Caroline's sacrifice must be honored. Sometimes in theater, timing can be everything. Though it was critically acclaimed and earned Ms. Tesori her 3rd Tony nomination, Caroline or Change had a tough time selling tickets and ultimately had a short run on Broadway. But this story resonates in a different way in 2021 than when it originally premiered in 2004, specifically with the epilogue, which tells the story of a Confederate statue being pulled down by the child of a black maid in Lake Charles, Louisiana, 1963.
Just one last thing left unsaid. Who was there when that statue fell? Who knows where they put his head? That old copper nightmare man. Who can say what happened that night at the courthouse? I can. I was there that night, I saw. I watched him topple like a tree. We were scared to death we'd break the law. Scared we'd fail, scared of jail. But still we stayed. In And I say, statue, statue, you are through. Statue answer, well, who are you? I say, evil, you got to go. Evil answer, who says so? I say, Emmy, Emmy Thibodeau. I'm the child of a maid in her uniform, crisp and clean. Nothing can ever make me afraid. You can't hold on, you nightmare man. Your time is past now, on your way. Get gone and never come again. For change come fast and change come slow. But everything changes and you got to go. Shall, shall, devil or not, I'm the child of a maid. She stands alone where the harsh winds blow. Salt in the earth, so nothing grow too close. But still, her strong blood flow. Underground, through hidden veins, down from storm clouds when it rains. Down the plain, down the high plateau, down to the Gulf of Mexico. Down to Larry and Emmy and Jackie and Joe, the children of Caroline Thibodeau.
to 14G. So cozy, calm, and peaceful. Heaven for a mouse like me. With quiet by the least full. Pets are banned, parties too, and no solicitations. Window seat with garden view. A perfect nook to read a book. I'm lost in my Jane Austen when I hear. Ooh. Not the flat below. From an opera wannabe in 13G, a matinee of some cantata, Wagner's Ring and Traviata.
Scoring the music for a variety of animated films, including sequels to The Little Mermaid, Mulan, and the third installment of the Shrek franchise, Jeanine was approached with the idea to adapt Shrek into a stage musical. DreamWorks made it clear that they didn't simply want to Xerox an exact copy of the movie and put it on stage. They encouraged Jeanine and lyricist book writer David Lindsay Abeer to dig deeper and make it their own through expanded backstory and new developments. They wanted to find the unique seed of each character that they could nurture and bring to life in a really specific way. You can hear this dedication to each character's specificity through the music. Depending on who's singing, the score ranges from funk to R&B to classical music to golden age musical theater. The writing duo workshopped over 50 songs, four of which were written during previews, and two more after Broadway rehearsals had already started. You can see for yourselves how Fiona, Shrek, and Lord Farquaad made the move from screen to stage.
I picked this flower right over there is where it grew. And I don't really like it, but it made me think of you because it's pretty. And what I'm trying to say is you are all so pretty, but I like you anyway. So please accept this flower with petals and a stem, which represent my feeling and tells you how. Oh man, I'm in trouble. When words fail, what will I do? When words fail, how will she know how I feel? When words fail, will I fail too? Hello, fair princess. Oh look, the moon is out tonight. You remind me of that moon because it's big and bright. And by big I don't mean chubby. Obviously you're not fat, but your personality is biggish, is what I meant by that. Sorry about that fat thing, I'm on the hefty side myself. I have to blame the gene pool, which reminds me of... Where am I going with this? When words fail, what will I do? When words fail, how will she know how I feel? When words fail, will I fail too? Do I have a snowball's chance? Are my prospects just too grim? I spent my whole life in the mud. Now I'm crawling out on a limb. If words fail, she'll know what I mean. If words fail, she'll take my hand and see me like no one else has. If words fail, she'll understand. She'll understand.
My daddy was a miner, so he wasn't much around, foraging the diamonds, a life spent underground. Daddy didn't talk much, he barely said hello. He simply muttered, "Hi-ho," and off to work he'd go. Daddy was grumpy, my mama was a princess who left her crown behind. Daddy was her true love, so mommy didn't mind. I never knew my mama, but she could have been a queen. She married way beneath her, beneath her knee, I mean. Oh, daddy's bed was lumpy, so mommy couldn't sleep. Daddy built a new one, so tall and so steep. 25 mattresses she slept upon. One night she rolled over, and mama was gone. So daddy was grumpy. Me and my old man, a tale as old as dirt. A bitter, distant father in a tiny undershirt. Daddy up and left me, left me good as dead. Now he lives in squalor, sleeping seven to a bed. I can see my future, and so it shall be done. It's total domination, with some torture just for fun. 'Cause I will have my wedding, and I will have a queen. I get that crown on, you will get the guillotine. And I'll punish you, daddy, 'cause I'm a grown-up and bigger
than you'll ever know. You're gonna pay, Daddy. It's any day, Daddy. I'm off to work. Hi-ho.
Our next number, more to the story, is a beautiful number originally written for Princess Fiona, as she puts on her wedding dress minutes before she is to be married to Lord Farquaad. But sometimes great songs are lost out of town. As Jeanine sat in the audience during one of her preview performances, she could feel a child kicking her seat from behind. It was clear that after sitting through a whole 2.5 hour show, children didn't have the patience to sit through a 3-minute ballad, no matter how lovely it is. The number was ultimately taken down, and though it was a difficult decision, she knew she made the right choice when her younger daughter said, "Mom, that's a great cut."
This is by the book. A picture perfect bride. I got my happy ending in a fairy tale, the knot must get tied. This is what I dreamed. Finally, it's real. I knew what I would look like, but I never thought how I might feel. And there's more, more, more to the story. What you so often read isn't always so. There's more, more to the story. Now I know. Every princess is a beauty. Every dragon must be cruel. Big goes with bad, and royal goes with duty. We play our parts, we follow every rule. This is by the book. I knew it from the start. The ogre tries to hurt you, but I never knew they meant in the heart. And there's more, more, more to the story. What you so clearly see isn't always so.
Premiered in 2015 and is the first Broadway musical to ever have a lesbian protagonist. Jeanine says it is the most important musical she's ever written. A woman close to her age, on stage, looking backward as much as looking forward, and trying to understand and grapple with how your parents both gifted and burdened you. A universal experience of aging and maturing. This memory play was adapted from a graphic memoir of the same name and tells the story of Alison Bechdel as she discovers her sexuality, her relationship with her gay father, and her attempts to unlock the mysteries surrounding his life and eventual suicide.
The book is so dense and layered that each song had to accomplish many things at the same time. In most great musicals, the story follows a linear time structure. Like in life, there's a yesterday, a today, and a tomorrow. But Fun Home is a memory play. Any character could be anywhere doing anything at any time. So how do you decide where a song goes? It's so hard to structure a story when you are in complete control of the chronology. Ring of Keys is probably the most well-known song of the show and Alison Bechdel's personal favorite. But Jeanine stands firm that it could have been the opening number, the finale, or anywhere in between. That the placement was not the priority, but rather that we saw a child, Ernest, vulnerable and longing for love.
We all have a relationship to that desire, wanting to be seen and known and accepted. But Jeanine and Lisa were anxious to write the song because while we can all identify that desire in retrospect, how do you articulate it through the eyes and language of a child experiencing it for the first time? You'll see a lot of the lines in the song go unfinished because young Alison simply doesn't have the words yet. She searches for language as she searches for love and her newfound identity.
Someone just came in the door, like no one I ever saw before. I feel, I don't know where you came from. I wish I did, I feel so dumb. I feel you were swagger.
From Jeanine's most recent work, Soft Power. In politics, soft power is the ability to attract and co-opt, rather than coerce. In other words, soft power involves shaping the preferences of others through appeal and attraction. It chooses inspiration over intimidation, hope over fear, and tomorrow over yesterday.
It felt like the perfect way to end this night as we continue into this new year.
I was taught
in the land of the free.
I was taught
with a spring and me life.
Life.
Liberty.
Liberty.
How can I turn my back
on democracy? And I forget what I really should know. I forget that it's such a big, big show.
Still I dream.
Just enough, worthy of trust enough, kind enough, smart enough,
with a big heart enough, good and grown up enough,
to lift us up,
lift us up,
and
welcome to America,
America.
Our country's a disaster.
This is America.
So many ways, but we have the power.
Travel on.